Hello everyone, welcome to MBBS classes. Myself, Dr. Hanifa. Today I'll be talking on acute otitis media. Acute otitis media is defined as the acute inflammation of the middle ear cleft, which is characterized by the collection of purulent middle ear effusion and other constitutional symptoms such as fever and earache. So this is a diagram of the middle ear cleft showing the tympanic membrane. This is a tympanic cavity proper and the eustachian tube. So in the acute otitis media, this whole middle ear cleft is involved. Acute otitis media is a common childhood disease. Otitis media is divided into acute otitis media and otitis media with effusion. These two classifications of otitis media are based on the sign and symptoms. In this video, we'll be talking only on acute otitis media. Now let's see the natural history of acute otitis media. First of all, it begins with the viral infections. The early infection, they involve only the mucosal and the submucosal layers of the tympanic cavity, which means the bone is not involved. It results in the edema of the mucosa, which is lining the tympanic cavity and the middle ear cleft. There are cilias which get disrupted in function, and there is eustachian tube blockage. As a result of these changes, there is increase in the number of goblet cells and the intratympanic gases, it gets absorbed. Due to the absorption of the intratympanic gases, the negative pressure is developed, which leads to retracted tympanic membrane, and the fluid starts collecting as exudates. So, as the amount of fluid increases, the collection inside the tympanic cavity, it increases, and the part of the membrane which is under the greatest tension, it undergoes pressure necrosis and capillary thrombosis. So, as a result of necrosis, the part which is most tensed, it undergoes rupture. So, as the tympanic membrane ruptures, the patient initial presentation of earache and temperature, it is relieved. But sometimes what happens is that when the infective agent is very virulent, in those cases, it involves the master ear cell system also. There occurs the pressure necrosis. Due to when the master ear cells are involved, it can be identified by the change in the nature of discharge. The discharge becomes purulent. And again, there will be recurrence of symptoms such as earache and fever. So, in cases of virulent agent from the acute otitis media, it can lead to mastoiditis also. Now, let's see the microbiology of acute otitis media. Initially, in most of the cases, the initial pathogen is virus. The bacteria which are commonly being cultured and identified and held responsible for acute otitis media are Streptococcus pneumonia, Haemophilus influenzae, and Moraxella catheralis. The other bacteria which are also sometimes causing the acute otitis media are group A Streptococcus and Staphylococcus aureus. Nowadays, acute otitis media is associated with another causative factor known as biofilms. Biofilms are the sessile communities of bacteria which is attached to the surface, and they are encased in a protective matrix of exopolysaccharides. So this matrix of the polysaccharides, it protects these bacteria from the defense system of the host, and it renders them resistant to the antibiotics. Recent studies have shown the role of biofilms in the development of acute otitis media, and in the nasopharynx, the biofilms are identified. So in some patients, there is a biofilm layer present over the adenoid tissue, and in those cases, adenoidectomy helps in the resolution of the acute otitis media. The pathophysiology of acute otitis media is multifactorial. The factors which are responsible for development are host factors, environmental factors, anatomic factors, and infections. Among the host factors, the first is the age. The highest incidence of acute otitis media is seen in infants between 6 to 12 months of age. And it is seen that acute otitis media, if it occurs before 6 months or 12 months of age, then it is a powerful predictor of recurrence. Under the gender, there is no significant statistical difference found between the male and female. Genetics is one of the proposed risk factors for acute otitis media, but study, they are showing equivocal results. Sometimes defect in the immune system, such as phagocyte function, humoral or local immunity, or infection with the HIV virus can predispose to the development of acute otitis media. The role of allergy in acute otitis media is still under study. Under the environmental factors, the factors which are responsible are daycare of the small children, because in daycare the risk of cross infection seasonal, it is seen more during the winter season, because in winter the viral rate of viral infection is more. Acute otitis media is associated with low socioeconomic status, because there is increased rate of infection due to overcrowding and due to the poor access to the healthcare. It is seen that the lack of breastfeeding is associated with high risk of developing acute otitis media, because the breastfeeding, it protects against the colonization of bacteria. So 6 months of exclusive breastfeeding is recommended. Family history is another, again, risk factor for development of acute otitis media. Now coming to the anatomic factors, the most important is the direction of the eustachian tube in infants. Infants are more susceptible to develop the acute otitis media, because in infants, if you remember from the anatomy classes, the length is short, it is wider, and it is horizontally located. So any sort of infection from the nasopharynx, it is transferred very easily from the nasopharynx to the middle ear cavity. Next is the craniofacial abnormalities like cleft palate. In syndromes like Down syndrome and Treacher's colon syndrome, it is seen that the eustachian tube, it doesn't function properly. So in these conditions, this group of patients are more susceptible to develop acute otitis media. Now the last factor is the infection. Among the infection, the virus is the initial pathogen which causes the acute otitis media. It destroys the mucociliary system of the middle ear cleft, which, because of that, there is a secondary bacterial invasion which leads to the development of the acute otitis media. Now coming to the clinical presentation, the clinical presentation is varied. There is fever, earache, fullness of the ear, or reduced hearing. In young children who are not able to tell their complaint, there will be increased irritability and inconsolable crying, and we have to notice if there is any change in the eating or the sleeping habits. Sometimes the features like malaise, vomiting and diarrhea may be present. So stages of acute otitis media, they are divided into 5 stages. The first stage is the stage of tubal occlusion. In this stage, the eustachian tube gets blocked. Because of the blocking of the eustachian tube, the middle ear air is absorbed. It leads to the development of negative pressure in the tympanic cavity, and the tympanic membrane gets retracted. So that on examination findings, the tympanic membrane will be retracted and it will be dull in appearance. In the stage of tubal occlusion, the clinical presentation will be fullness or mild ear pain and little bit decreased hearing, but there will not be any fever. Next is the stage of pre-suppuration, where the inflammation of the middle ear cleft starts. The patients, they present with earache. The earache, it increases in intensity. The hearing difficulty also is, it intensifies. There will be fever, irritability and excessive crying. On examination of the tympanic membrane, we will get congested with dilated vessels radiating from the handle of the malleus. It gives the appearance of cartwheel appearance. And sometimes in few patients in the stage of pre-suppuration, we may get serous exudate in the middle ear. So as you can see here in this, there are 2 pictures showing the stage of pre-suppuration. This is the initial stage of pre-suppuration, where we can see few congested vessels which are running along the handle of the malleus. There is a slight erythematous change of the tympanic membrane. This is another picture of the pre-suppuration stage, where we can see the collection in the middle ear, which is looking like a serous exudate. In the stage of suppuration, the clinical presentation, it becomes more intense. That means the earache, it is more throbbing. with the other generalized symptoms. The exudate, which was serous in the presuppurative stage, it becomes purulent in the suppurative stage. Because of that, sometimes there may be bulging and hyperemia of the membrane is increased. Sometimes we may get a yellow spot at the site of bulge, which signifies the area of maximum pressure on the drum. This is a picture of the tympanic membrane showing the erythematous tympanic membrane with the bulging of the tympanic membrane in the posterior quadrant, and so this is a stage of suppuration. Sometimes when this bulging it increases, when the content of the fluid in the middle ear it increases, it will burst. So in the stage of suppuration we may get lighthouse sign, that means that there will be pulsating discharge which reflects the light intermittently. Next is the stage of resolution. When the infection in the middle ear it resolves, the tympanic membrane, it returns to normal appearance and function. But in some percentage of cases, the tympanic membrane may not resolve to normal. So there may be certain complications which usually happen due to inadequate treatment and ill drainage. So this is one picture, otoscopic picture showing a perforation of the tympanic membrane. As the tympanic membrane perforates, we can see here few bubbles, which is signifying this is the ear discharge in the canal, and the drum color has returned to normal. So when a patient is coming with the findings of acute otitis media, we have to do the audiological test. So in acute otitis media, we usually get mild to moderate conductive hearing loss. The assessment of hearing is important, as impaired hearing, it predisposes to delay in speech and language development in young children. So this is an audiogram show. This is the bone conduction curve and this is the ear conduction curve. So the AB gap is more than 10 dB, which is signifying conductive type of hearing loss. So in cases of acute otitis media, to document the nature of disease, to document the middle ear pathology, we have to do the tympanometry. In acute otitis media, we will get B type of curve. In the B type of curve, the tympanogram is flat in shape. There will not be any pressure peak. So this is a B type of tympanogram. We can see here that it is a flat type of curve. The canal volume is normal and in the peak there is no peak. So B type tympanogram is suggestive of otitis media with effusion or acute otitis media. So how to diagnose? Diagnosis, it is the main role is played by the history. Next, it is based on the otoscopic, microscopic and hedonic examination. Hedonic examination, it is helpful to identify the conditions which predisposes to otitis media, like cleft palate, in Down syndrome and in Teacher's colon syndrome. In the otoscopic examination, the pneumatic otoscopy, it plays a vital role because reduced mobility of the tympanic membrane, it is indicative of loss of compliance of the membrane, which is seen in effusion of the middle ear. Next, for the diagnosis, we have to do the audiological investigations like pure tone audiometry, tympanometry and acoustic reflectometry. Now coming to the treatment. In the initial stages, the medical treatment is enough in most of the patients. Under the medical treatment, as per the guidelines, amoxicillin is the first line of antibiotic for non-severe episodes. Amoxicillin is usually given at the dose of 90 mg per kg per day in 2 divided doses for 7 to 10 days. But for severe cases, it is recommended to give a combination of amoxicillin and clavulanic acid. Cephalosporin is prescribed as first line only when there is allergy to penicillin group of medicines. And if a patient is allergic to both the penicillin or cephalosporin, then macrolides are recommended. Along with the antibiotics, decongestant and antihistaminics, they can be prescribed. Now coming to the surgical treatment of acute otitis media. Under the surgical treatment, the first is myringotomy or tympanosynthesis, which is usually done under general anesthesia. The advantage of myringotomy is that it provides relief of pain and also provides the sample for culture and sensitivity. In cases of patients suffering from recurrent otitis media, it is recommended to undergo myringotomy with tympanostomy tube insertion. It is seen that in few patients with enlarged adenoids, which is hampering the drainage of eustachian tube and which is a source of biofilm, in those cases, adenoidectomy with or without tonsillectomy can be done, and it shows only, according to the clinical trial, it shows only modest benefit in acute otitis media, but it is not recommended as the first line procedure. Now let us see what are the intratemporal complications and sequelae. The intratemporal complications can be hearing loss. There may be some balance problems, acute perforation of the tympanic membrane, mastoiditis if the disease it extends beyond the mucosa to the and involves the periosteum of the mastoid. Next is the petrositis and labyrinthitis. Sequelae of acute otitis media can change to chronic suppurative otitis media or adhesive otitis media. It is also a risk factor for development of cholesteatoma, tympanosclerosis, ossicular discontinuity, or fixation. In very rare cases, sometimes acute otitis media can also cause intracranial complications like meningitis, subdural abscess, brain abscess, and lateral sinus thrombosis. These complications will be discussed in another video. Nowadays, the attention is paid for the prevention of the disease. So prevention of the disease, it is dependent on the prevention and the modification of the risk factors. Risk factors, we have already discussed, host factors, environmental factors, anatomic factors, and infections. So out of these factors, there are certain factors which can be modified. Among this is that promotion of breastfeeding. Nowadays, the exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months is advised because breastfeeding, it provides immunity to the infant and it prevents the colonization of the bacteria in the nasopharynx. Another method of prevention of the disease is by avoiding the supine bottle feeding and excessive use of pacifier. Next is the use of vaccines. The three most common bacteria which is isolated from the middle ear are Streptococcus pneumonia, Haemophilus influenza, and Moraxella catharalis. Out of these bacteria, vaccine is developed against Streptococcus pneumonia in the form of Pneumovax and Prevnar vaccine. And next is the influenza vaccine, which is the only available recommended viral vaccine today that is having an impact on the otitis media. So if a patient is coming with acute otitis media, what are the other diseases to be considered? In young children and infants, we have to rule out teething problems, mal-erupting tooth in the children, and oral pharyngolosis in adults. With this, I conclude. Thank you for watching this video.